call the meeting to order, and we do have a quorum with all board members present. Thank you for being here. Thank you all for being here. All right, this time we'll discuss the November 16th regular board meeting agenda item. Dr. Hamel?
Mr. President, the first, wow. The first, item is that to ask the board to approve the 2017-18 district improvement plan and campus improvement plans, and we have a presentation for you.
Good evening, Mr. President, honored members of the board, and Dr. Randall. This evening, we have the district improvement plan. The first component of the district improvement plan consists of a self-evaluation called the Comprehensive Needs Assessment. By law, we evaluate ourselves in 8 different areas that include demographics, student achievement, climate and culture, staff quality, curriculum, instruction and assessment, community and student engagement, school organization, and technology. Based on this, we identify strengths and areas of need where we include and incorporate into the district improvement plan. Strengths we identified this year was continued growth. We are becoming the true destination district. Increase in career technology education enrollments and industry certifications. All areas were above the state average on the STAR exam. All campuses earned a rating of MET standard. Our campuses earned a combined 76 distinction designations. We had on the Your Voice survey a favorable community, student, and staff impression. And our teacher experience is above the state average. Areas of need that we identified included planning for continued growth, improving the STAR, ELA, and social studies scores, closing achievement gaps for ELL, English language learner, special ed, and economically disadvantaged students, something called college and career and military readiness, which is how well we prepare students after they leave our campuses and go off to their adult pursuits, recruiting quality teachers, supporting school leadership, and incorporating technology applications lessons into instruction. To discuss the structure of the district improvement plan, Ms. Vogt will cover how we incorporated the priorities.
Thank you, Brian. This year, we hope you've noticed that we've reorganized the plan significantly. The cabinet spent probably a total of between 20 and 30 hours really studying, going through our needs assessment, and then preparing a further term probably you're all familiar with, SMART goals, which are specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, and timely goals. And with that being said, we also broke down all of the silos and truly integrated and worked together in improving programs. So as we present this evening, we'll be sharing and folding over each other in different areas. It's organized according to our 5 district priorities, and to make it a little bit easier, we included those in the footer so that you can just reference in the footer what section of the district priorities that the plan happens to be addressing. And then finally, we did add one extra priority at the end, and that particular priority is one that addresses one of the draft audit recommendations, and that is establishing a good, strong leadership pipeline in preparation for our future growth. So we'll be addressing each one of those in just a moment, and Brian, I'll let you share the rest.
Okay. In just a minute, I will be handing out this form to you. This form identifies the draft recommendations from the audit and areas where we're either in progress or where we have incorporated that information into the district improvement plan. And as I pass this out, the cabinet will come forward for a discussion of the priorities.
Thank you.
incorporated.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll begin with District Priority One, but before addressing that, we wanted to make note that we'll be reviewing this on a quarterly basis, and we'll be happy to report back to the board our status on each of these specific goals at that time. District Priority One has to do basically with improving and advancing the instructional programs within the district. As you probably already read through that, we'll just hit some highlights of it. Has to do with, of course, improving and working on our core goals and core curriculum areas. To that extent, the curriculum coordinators and the coaches continually enhance and work on adding resources and completing the curriculum in more innovative ways. They also work on our assessment process. We have a rather lengthy process in developing the district assessment, and that process yields a correlation factor of about 0.7. If you're familiar with that, they're excellent predictors of STAR, so they serve as formative assessments for the teachers throughout the year. Also in that piece, we address advanced placement, as well as improving the number of minority students or underrepresented students in our elementary gifted and talented program.
The technology areas, included in the district improvement plan in priority one, which is the instructional program, ensuring student mastery of the technology applications, TEKS, improving student access to technology and instructional technology resources at school and at home, supporting underserved AP students by providing laptops, internet access, and training, supporting teachers, students, and parents in the rollout of the Canvas Learning Management System, sustaining and expanding the use of the Skyward Student Information System, and helping our campus libraries meet state standards for available resources. In priority two, which deals with the financial health of the district, technology services goals include redesigning, restructuring, and automating business and operations functions, as well as developing written procedures and documentation to govern and guide technology support activities. And then in priority four, dealing with safety and security of the district, our goals include improving resiliency, consistency, safety, and security of the district network and systems.
Priority two addresses planning for the financial health of the district, so the business division functions are typically in that area. We've planned for improvement by establishing a rolling three-year financial forecast for the general fund, by demonstrating a significant commitment to financial transparency by improving communication of information to stakeholders and community with enhanced postings to the district website and a newly designed budget book. We'll be developing a comprehensive policies and procedures manual that describes how critical tasks are performed on a daily basis. We'll be upgrading financial and related software and processes impacting accounts payable, accounts receivable, payroll, and financial processing functions, increasing the efficiency and effectiveness of the food service operation by improving a variety of production metrics and by restructuring operational functions to more appropriately support campuses and respond to district growth. And finally, we'll be improving the efficiency of procurement and delivery functions by making adjustments to routes and increasing direct delivery options, as well as improving legal procurement compliance via the implementation of a standard commodity code system. As covered in priorities 1, 2, and 3, in the area of student accountability data, we'll improve accuracy by working with campus staff to ensure that data collection processes yield accurate data entry, while stressing the critical nature of the data and the impact on financial results.
Also in priority two, we will strive to staff schools with 98% accuracy on the first day of school, while ensuring that low-income and minority students are taught by experienced and effective teachers who are appropriately certified. We will improve staff retention rates by 1% through innovative compensation packages and programs with a focus on auxiliary staff. Consistent time management procedures will be implemented to monitor, analyze, and report compensatory time worked by non-exempt employees, including the tightening of internal controls that require enhanced managerial review processes. And in the area of priority four, which is safety and security, we will implement specific strategies to empower all staff to create a safe and drug-free school environment.
And some of the specific highlights of priority one, which is to continue to make improvements and advances in the instructional program, our district-wide core content achievement will increase by an average of 4% in statewide assessments in English language arts, math, science, and social studies. The district will provide laptop and internet hotspots to Title I kindergarten and pre-K students over the summer, which is also known as Project Grow. Special ed students will achieve a 10% increase in scores on STAR in all content areas through targeted staff development, which includes quarterly special ed teacher meetings, specific training on IEPs, individual educational plans, and usage reports on all interventions being used. Staff development, sheltered instructional strategies, and a targeted instructional program will increase performance on all state assessments in English language learners.
In district priority three, the continued improvements in career and technology education, the secondary CTE programs will continue to support our graduates' college and career readiness by ensuring the students who are enrolled in our dual credit and our articulated dual credit courses successfully pass those courses, resulting in earned college credit. In addition, the CTE students that are enrolled in courses that have an associated certification, those students will register for the certification, be supported, and successfully pass the certification for that particular course. We anticipate a 25% increased enrollment in our CTE-specific WCJC dual credit courses that are partnered with our TSTC certification courses for the next school year. In District Priority 4, we will continue to make improvements to our safety and security in the district, specifically with our elementary and secondary campuses by color track, focused on a safe and secure and drug-free programs that are aligned within that color track.
And District Priority 5 is on page 78, and it covers the development of a coordinated board administration outreach communication program. And this priority includes three SMART goals for the 17-18 school year, including the development and implementation of a comprehensive strategic plan, a plan to review and centralize several of our community and parent involvement practices, and that includes ensuring that every single campus has at least one affiliated organization, and a plan to review and centralize some of our internal communication strategies to make sure that our key messages are reaching every level of our organization.
We conclude on page 82 with our organizational culture and leadership segment. This particular segment is designed to develop the capacity of our sitting principal. We are providing them, beginning with the timelines indicated in the document, a three-tier approach to helping to develop principal capacity. The first tier will be for principals with 0 to 3 years experience. Second tier are those who are 4+ years of experience, and then often principals who are masters at their craft. They know that both the art and the science of quality leadership sometimes get neglected. So we've determined we're going to create also a way for them to extend their skill sets, to collaborate with principals around the country, and to really increase and help them become mentor principals for others in the district. With that being said, finding new principals and highly talented principals will be facilitated by our own leadership pipeline. We've formed a partnership with UHV, University of Houston, Victoria. They'll be teaching a master's cohort here in the district and have agreed to let one of our top-tier principals serve as the instructor for the course, the adjunct professor, while we also partner with professors there at the U of H campus. In this course, we opened applications by recommendation only from principals on some of our top teachers within the district. We had 31 names submitted, and of those 31, using a rubric, we were able to select 20 names to begin the cohort in December. The cohort will be principles of leadership provided for youth of age, combined with some micro-credentialing as well as down-to-earth application to partner with the theory piece of the course that members of the cabinet will be able to teach and support the new fledgling administrators in. We're really excited about this opportunity. It's probably unique in the state right now in that it's a collaboration between a district as well as the university system in developing the skill sets of principals and principals to be in a manner that will complete the experience more so than just having the theory at the university level. Are there any questions?
What I'd like to do is, I know normally our format is to ask questions. There's so much here. We could form all these questions, but I'd like to move more to discussion about this. I think we've probably got comments that we'd like to make as well, so I'd like to use that format at least for this portion of it and not try to question everything, rather just have a discussion about this huge amount of work that you've done. So I'll open it up with comments and questions from the board.
Well, first, I'm going to go first. I just want y'all to know that I don't believe that our intention was to cause you guys to work 30 hours on one piece of work. Hopefully, our intention was to come up with a strategic plan that we can move forward as our district grows, something that we can have a firm foundation going forward. And obviously, this is a lot of information that you guys have given us. One of the things that, and I haven't had a chance to fully look at the audit report, but one of the concerns that I've always had is not how hard you were working, but because I know that you do, but more in terms of the support that you have to be able to do each of your jobs. I have a question for anybody who wants to answer. And again, I haven't looked at the full audit report. I know we're going to have a presentation on Thursday, but how do you plan to be able to accomplish the goals that you have set? And they are pretty no later than May 18th. Most of this is 2017. You have set high goals. How do you plan to do that with the current staff without, we don't want to wear you to the bones either. Personally, I empathize with the situation that you're in and this just being thrown at you as well.
That's a very good question and probably one that every central office in the state has to cope with simply because of the design of school districts. There's so much money obviously coming in. The revenue stream is certainly something I'm not that familiar with, to be honest, but it tends to be the mission of any district to put that revenue stream where no matter how good you are in every other aspect, if you don't have quality teachers in the classroom, that's where the money really has to go. On our end, I think I can speak for all of us and is that you have to learn to work smart. You have to leverage the information that you can get through technology to detect patterns, to make sure you've identified problems correctly and not based on assumptions. You do things like that, and you can really leverage the tool and the collaboration of a team to achieve a lot more than just by adding more and more people.
And I think one of the comments that was made earlier, the move toward moving out of silos and doing your work and collaborating with one another, and instead of doing multiple types of things, when you work together, you're able to be a little bit more efficient.
And I would say just real quick that this year is probably the first year that we really collectively tried to go through all five priorities as a group. And so, personally, I don't think there's one thing in this district improvement plan that we all didn't have some sort of collaboration or oversight in. And so you heard different folks talking about district priority 1 and 3 and 4. And so we really went through this as a team with the plan to try to get this knocked out this calendar year, which is an annual district improvement plan. So I think having those conversations together, we were able to bite off what we felt was appropriate as a team.
Mr. Roberts, I'd also like to add that in the area of ours, achieving some of the goals is actually going to reduce our workload. If we can improve our staff retention and address some of those issues, it's actually the long range is more beneficial because we will reduce the amount of work that we have to do in my department.
Well, I just want you to know that I know how hard you work every single day and the long hours you put in, and I certainly never intended for any of this to create even more of that, and I certainly look forward to the day that it will alleviate some of the workload that you have.
Okay.
I'll go next.
All right. That's okay. First of all, I did go through the district improvement plan, and then I read through several times the little bit of information we've now been given about the audit. And
well, the majority of the board's at a disadvantage because only the sub-team has seen the full report. And they will, on Thursday night, they'll give a snapshot as y'all of what they're going to see, and then we're going to do a full review with the board after that. So most board members are at a significant disadvantage about what's in there. So some of this is a surprise for them, too. So,
but I can significantly see where you've tried to take some of the information that's already been given to you, which was massive, and put it into the district improvement plan, which we do appreciate. It wasn't like waiting, okay, this sounds right. And it's amazing what some areas we came up with. A couple of areas that I would like a question, and one in particular because it's near and dear to my heart. I worry so much about the two and out, three and out teachers that come into the district, we invest in them, and then they're gone. And we really don't always know why. And have we put any look at, is it more of just teachers that have come in with experience, or is it a lot of our, or what we call early teachers? And I know we have an amazing mentor program, but we only do it for 1 year. And I don't know if we've looked at or could think about what's the next step to keep some of those teachers and be supportive of them as they move forward. And I guess I'm asking if those are things that you're going to be looking at.
And the mentor program actually falls under Val's domain, but I will talk a little bit about the retention. We are, our retention rate, and for a growing district, which is really good, our retention rate is better than the state. And so that is something that we're actually quite proud of. And we are beginning to collect data on the reasons for resignations, although it is up to the employee to provide that information. We are collecting it in actually two different locations to have some comparisons, and we are able to run data on that. So for the first time, we're really starting to collect some information. So that hopefully will be helpful. You brought up an interesting point about connecting the reason for resignation with the years of experience, and I'm going to have to do a little homework and see if we'll be able
but
to do that.
But that might be something that would be helpful to look at. And I do, after we go to these conventions and things and we listen to other districts, we are actually doing very well. The other, and I was just picking up on what you said, it's the University of Houston of Victoria. They're going to come actually on the campus and do a master's, it a master's program?
Yes, ma'am.
Is that at our cost or the expense of the people that you have picked to train?
That is, well, we have some feelers out for scholarship programs for them. It will be at the cost of the individual, but it's about a third of the cost of a master's program because they are using our facilities here in LCISD.
They don't have to travel.
There's no travel, and there's also no building usage fees, none of those typical fees when you go on campus. So they're getting, it's one of the lowest in the state.
I think that's a fabulous, because I think that's the reason that many people don't go to the next levels, because time, cost.
Distance. Do we already have like a pilot program that is doing that for some of our teachers? We had one last year, very similar, but in that it was a typical program. It wasn't the hybrid, and we were very intentional about the teachers that were invited to this. They're teachers who have aspirations of leadership. I believe that Ms. Lang was
telling us, I think in the last year and a half, she's hired 15 administrators.
14.
14 administrators. And it isn't that we don't have strong retention rates, it's the growth of the district, and then your typical husband transferred or staying home with young children, things like that. So for us to grow with the district, we really need a leadership pipeline and to perpetuate a quality culture. Without a culture breaking down, we need a leadership pipeline of individuals who exhibit the best there is in an educator and prepare them to fill those roles of leadership.
You said they were nominated by the Evanston schools, is that?
Yes, ma'am. They were nominated by a principal. They were vetted by several different teams. They had to submit a recommendation from their principal, from an assistant principal, and from someone that they had mentored or someone that had mentored them. And so we looked at that. Then we also looked at factors like how much professional development have they pursued in the past that was not mandatory, and in what areas of that. Obviously, in certain areas, you looked at their student growth potential. Were they good instructional leaders in the classroom? What were their leadership roles on their campus? We had quite a rubric established there, so that the teachers that we got, we felt like would really fulfill the definition of a LCISD principal.
Yes, excellent. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. On the principals, is that from elementary, junior high, high school? How many? Is it proportionate or not?
Yes, it was serendipitous. We decided that we wanted to really look at merit alone, but it just so happened that it was almost Dr. Bowen, 50-50?
It was almost 50-50, right. There were 21, so it couldn't exactly be 50-50. But
so they're high school at every level. Every level they'll be covered.
As well as diversity, which was, again, it was unintentional, but we were very pleased.
I'm going to preface my comments with back years ago, my wife and I, we were forming a PTO, and we lived up in Connecticut. And we had to take a personality profile thing. And she came out random abstract, and I came out concrete sequential.
How did you guess?
And that concrete sequential personality wakes me up at 1 o'clock in the morning. And I'm north of 3, and I'm saying, why, if this is a 2017-18 plan, are we getting it in November? Why is this not the beginning of the year? If this is a year-long plan, that's a start like steering the ship. You know, you got to start turning back here if you're going to make the port. Why do we do this in November instead of the beginning of the year? We've already, we're behind the curve.
I believe at this time the reason was that the operational audit was due quite a bit earlier, and we really did want to look at the draft. If you're going to create a dip, you wanted to make sure you could really hit at the heart of the matter, and there were some recommendations that we very much wanted to include.
Well, I will congratulate you on that, including that. I, you know, as I read through this, I saw the SMART goals. Some of them I could say that is really a SMART goal. I saw the measurable. Some of them got a little squishy, and some of them got real squishy on the SMART. I'm not how sure. There weren't those measurements in there that in all of them. I would also compliment you the fact that priority one, the making improvements and advancement of the instructional program, that took up about half that entire document, which is where our focus should be. The next one, the core of the document, was to finance it. We don't finance it. So I congratulate you on that. I was a little bit surprised why I didn't see that organizational culture on the front page here with these other four priorities, because you had that one in there. That, to me, that's a critical piece. That was sort of lanyap. I got to the back and I said, where did that come from? I didn't find it in the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Part of that concrete sequential. I'm sorry about that. But also, we have these four priorities from the TEA and commissioner priorities. How do we relate what we've got here? There's nothing, there's no words I saw in this document that says, okay, this supports these in any fashion. How do we relate all this stuff we wrote back to those four priorities from the TEA?
So if we look at those priorities, recruiting, supporting, and retaining teachers and principals are a part of our activities, obviously. Building a foundation of math and reading can be found in our priority one. That is, in fact,
I read all those things down, and I say they relate, but you have these four big priorities up here, and there's nothing that, you know, there's no verbiage that tied those down to me. I have to go in there and read through the whole thing and get down to detail. And I understand the bits and pieces down through there. It looks like to me, it's just sort of dangling out there. I like kind of tramp, giving my data trail.
Okay.
And that's why, I read them up there, but unless I go through and read detail and everything down here, yeah, that relates to that. Yes, that relates to that. But to me, it was just a segue between those four. They're just sort of dangling in the front of this report. And it doesn't say, okay, doesn't give me any verbiage that leads me down the path that these are all included in that. So.
I'd be glad to include those in the footers.
So you want the numbers of the Texas...
I don't necessarily have those numbers. I don't want to go to that kind of detail. They were dangling out there, and there's nothing said. And we believe that, you know, listed down here in these priorities, all the stuff that we're doing are, you know...
We'll relate back to...
Like I say, there was no segue from that. They were just hanging out there in midair. And yes, I understand buried down in this, there's a ton of stuff buried down here. And again, I compliment you for what you've done, because to me, this was much more direct than I've seen before. You answered one of my questions a while ago, when do we see a report that says, here's how we're doing on this? And you answered that, this is going to be a quarterly report. Because if we don't look at that, then we have this, and next year we're back here looking at the same report again, and we have no clue where we... So I really appreciate that comment. Let's see. I compliment you also. The number of students enrolled in career and technical education programs continues to increase with 11% increase. I thought that was a great highlight. A couple of statistics that caused me to one of those moments again was under school culture and climate. I don't like to see a disparity of 81% of parents rated the school highly and 92% of staff rated it highly. How do we close that gap? You know, I'd be more comfortable. We rated it worse than our parents did, but. You know, to me, that we need to close that gap. Whatever we need to do, we need to have them the same perception we have, the pride we have in the district. We need that same pride from our parents. So I know that's a hard one to do, but that's a statistic jumped out. We did it again down there under curriculum instruction and assessment. 85% of teachers and over 75% of parents gave higher ratings. A 10% gap. That gives you all, I'm sure that's probably what keeps you up at night. From 1 to 3 o'clock in the morning. But, you know, that kind of stuff, the things we need to concentrate on. And, again, the way y'all have jumped into this and already taken some of the stuff, you can see some Holdsworth stuff in here. You can see some stuff that we had in that strategic plan or in the audit that we haven't even adopted yet. So, but I congratulate you on this. It's much, much more concise than it has been in the past, I think. There were a lot of measures in there. When we got down to campus improvement plans, most of those had, you know, we're going to do this percentage, this percentage, this percentage, and I really appreciated that. It sort of fell apart down at the ALC where everything's kind of fuzzy. We will increase, but it didn't have, and I know that's a whole different group of folks, but I really like, again, with my concrete sequential, if you give me those numbers, you give me those percentages, you give me some specific targets, you do the SMART goals, I can live with all that, so I'll get off my... Thank you all again for a huge amount of work.
And just as a reminder, Harvey also had an impact on the timing of this as well. So, but the staff has really done a really, really excellent job of working. We've got three major initiatives that we're dealing with right now, and trying to take and combine all of those so that doesn't operate in silos. Has been a huge task, and they have really worked extremely hard to try to accomplish
it. I can recognize anybody who looks at that can recognize it. Thank you for all your work. Yes, ma'am. You got another one?
I haven't said anything yet.
Oh, I thought that was your saying a while ago. Well, say something.
No. I do want to commend all of you in such hard work in such a short period of time. It was amazing. I know y'all are very determined and very committed, and this just proves it 100-fold. Anybody that would have taken that much time. I took some time, but I went more into the campus improvement. And this was just 8 hours, and you're 30 hours of establishing a five-year plan, so to speak, 5 to 10 year. The way you're organizing everything is exciting. This is what we've been missing. And I think y'all are the beginning, and I'm very proud of all of you. I have some comments about the campus, but I think that's probably going to have to go to another time, because the district, I kind of got focused in on campus improvements. I've got a lot of questions about that. Percentages bother me. I need numbers also. I do have a couple of questions that may sound, just because I don't understand. When you're talking about you're going to improve by 5% increase in a math, how do you come up with that percentage?
That's a really good question. And part of it has to do with when we examine the areas of weakness, we look at, let's say for example, and I always think algebra 1 and linear equations, because if you don't have that piece in place, it's going to crumble the whole program. So you look at, are they weak across the board, just a little weak in everything, in all of the skill sets, or is there one primary, they're called supporting TEKS and readiness TEKS. And readiness TEKS kind of form the foundation of your current grade level. Supporting TEKS are the skill sets that help catapult you successfully into the next grade level. So if you're looking at the readiness TEKS, you have to examine how many students, and then when we talk about working smarter, you determine, is it a district-wide phenomenon? Is it a phenomena that's occurring in a part of the district? Is it a phenomena that's occurring in Title I schools and not in the other school, or in a feeder system? And we look at that. We have data track meetings where we meet with the principals of each track, and we start analyzing it, and you can tell by where the patterns are how quickly and how fast you might be able to remediate or to fix it. So for some issues, you know, because of the pervasiveness of it, you may be able to move the needle 3% because it's going to mean massive instructional changes. 5% is typical when you know it's something that is low-hanging fruit, a perception that you're seeing on one or two questions on a EOC, for example. Is this helpful?
Yes, it's just if the board said, you know, 5% is too low, we want it to be 10%. Mm-hmm. What kind of impact does that have on you making changes?
Realistically, it may not be possible. It just depends on, again, on how pervasive the problem is that we're looking at. Sometimes 1 year we had a 16% hike in writing, but it was simply because that year the state had changed the resource materials and the amount of information they would allow the schools to access on what the writing prompt would look like. And when we found that this is what they were wanting, then across the state, everyone could realign their instructional program to that. So it really would depend on the area, but it's a little bit like if you went to a physician and you said, if this much medicine is good, if I take twice as much, will I get better twice as fast? That's probably an odd comparison, but it just really depends on the circumstances surrounding the deficit area.
There again, I mean, this, we're going to be, well, I won't be able to be here Thursday night for family reasons, but it says we're going to approve the district improvement plan and the campus improvement plan. So I have questions about the campus improvement plan. Is this something that I just need to wait and talk to another individual maybe about it? I just have a few questions of what I've found. Am I jumping to the next?
How many questions do you have? Because we
About 20.
No,
no, I, no, In all the reporting and the improvement plans, everything's considered grade 3 through 5, fifth grade, okay? My daughter used to be a teacher, and she was trying to explain this to me, that that's because of the test star and the TEA, the requirements start with the third grade. And when I was looking at some of the results, third grade reading in some schools were low, need improvement. What do we have set in place, or do we even talk about the kindergartners through the second grade? I have never seen reports or any kind of progress on those levels. So say if the second graders are already low in their reading and they carry over to the third grade, it's logical their reading level would probably start low. Is there a place, or do we get a report on the younger students?
Yes, ma'am. One of the reasons those aren't standardized as much is the age of the child. Developmentally, they change quite a bit. Back in the early 80s, the state did try and give standardized tests to first graders, and it was a bit of a disaster. And so they ceased doing that. However, they do have a list of approved tests that you do to determine our students at risk for not being on grade level at an early age. Those tests vary from kindergarten, first, and second, but the TPRI, for example, gives phonemic awareness. It addresses that piece of it. And then the DRA is the exam that's used to determine reading comprehension. In the district improvement plan, we did change our standards, and if you read in here at the district level, it is moved the bar for the reading comprehension to a different position, and we began implementing district assessments this year, not to take grades on, but just to see if our students are on track in those early grades as well. And we'd be glad to report to the board.
I would like to see that periodically, yes, ma'am. Okay, the rest I'll just get hold of somebody on the phone.
Well, again, a compliment. You have a moving target, and then we shuffle the deck on you every year when you get a whole new group of students and you got all these comparisons. So, again, appreciate your work very much. Thank you. Moving right along. Well, we need to spend some time on it. I mean, that's an important piece of work y'all have done. We don't ignore that.
Well, we go multitask, and while they are moving things back and resetting it, the next agenda item is that the Board of Trustees approved a 2018-2019 student course selection catalog. And the catalog has both the courses as well as the comments that are being that adjustments are being made.
Questions on that one?
Next one is consider approval of dual credit partnership with Wharton County Junior College. Consider approval of dual credit partnership agreement with Lone Star College System.
Would you like to comment on that one, Dr. Ramblis?
I actually have a question.
Oh, yes.
Ms. Hack, is there a possibility, and I guess perhaps this is a question for Ms. Bode as well, that we could...
As well.
sorry. That we could join or have a partnership with these colleges as well, or even the University of Houston, Victoria per se, to help some of our teachers become certified to teach those dual credit courses. I know that they have to have at least 18 hours graduate hours to be able to teach that course. And I think that the problem we're running into right now is not necessarily not wanting to offer these courses, but not having those teachers that are actually qualified to do that.
That is one of the reasons we pursued the MOU with Lone Star. We did an analysis of all of the community colleges in the areas that have articulated agreements with different universities. And Lone Star was the one by far and away that had a larger variety of courses that they would offer. Plus, they had three different delivery systems. So one of them was the traditional dual credit system that a master's degree in 18 hours in your content area, and then you apply and you get certified as a dual credit teacher. That was one of the methods. And then they had the virtual courses where we are able to, their teacher is projected into our classroom. And then they have the purely online courses. So they had three different avenues, and only one of those avenues actually required us to have a teacher with the 18 hours and the master's degree. So they are coming, actually, I believe on Thursday. They'll be doing a site visit here, and they're going to be looking at all of our computer facilities and examining how we're going to do this. And they have a soft rollout this spring, so that we'll begin offering courses through their venue. And the other option that we have is on-ramps, of course. And that program is expanding very rapidly in the district, and all of the high schools have people lined up to go through their training program. They do not require a master's or 18 hours either, but they do require 3 weeks at University of Texas, where they spend working with a professor there on the standards, and then they also have to pass the final and all of the exams through the UT system.
It's one of those areas that we're probably going to have to spend a little more time investigating, as far as a teacher who wants to teach the courses of those courses where 18 hours is required. How do they get attend the college or whatever it is to get those 18 hours? So that's something that we're probably going to have to look at a little more.
And during the hiring in the spring, that was a concerted effort on all the high school's part when they were looking at available staff and interviewing. And I can see a direct increase we're going to have for this next school year, that teachers that are going to be eligible to meet that 18 hours.
Well, and I think that, like we talked about, a lot of those teachers will go into administration or counseling or something else. And so we're, you know, those teachers
instead
are those
of that content,
people, right?
Yeah.
Instead of going into the content, I'm just wondering if there's something that we can do to encourage
them to stay in that area. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I think in just looking at them, Ms. Roberts, there seems to be a distinct separation, though, between those who would like to go into administration and counseling and those who are just in love with their content area. And developing them and giving them opportunities mm-hmm. like this, they live for that.
That's
so.
Thank you.
Next item is adoption of order canvassing returns and declaring results of the schoolhouse bond election of November 7th, 2017. We will provide it the order of canvassing return information at your desk.
I would like to take just a second to thank the board, because we had a lot of folks that did put boots on ground to help get this done. The administrators, the whole staff, everybody worked within the constraints that they are bound to, but everybody got out there and did a huge job in getting that done. And now it's up to us to commit to our voters out there that we will use this money wisely for the best facilities and the best educated kids in the country. Thank you, Dr. Randall.
Next item is consider ratification of financial and investment reports. Next item is consider approval of budget amendment requests. Next item is consider approval of revision to resolution and order authorizing the reappraisal of disaster area property within LCISD. If you recall, we had the board approve this previously, but the CAD encouraged us to change some of the wording here, so that it was more inclusive of actually how they were going to be doing that. Consider ratification of donations to the district. Casting of votes for Fort Bend County Appraisal District Board of Directors.
And word of explanation there, when we get to this vote on Thursday night, historically happens is the district would cast all their votes for the nominee that we put forth in the last meeting, and all the other entities put forth the nominee. You generally do exactly the same thing. You can split those up if you'd like to. I'm just telling you historically what has happened so they can make that decision on Thursday evening.
Consider approval of final payments for Pink Elementary School repairs in the amount of $25,862.71. Next item is they approve a deductive change order number 2 in the amount of $6,507.50 and final payment of $48,214.64 to American Mechanical Services for the chiller replacements at Alternative Learning Center and other schools that are listed. Next item is consider approval of CenterPoint Energy terms and conditions for Carter Elementary School. Next item is consider approval of change order number 1 for the natatorium at George Ranch High School. And we did have a quick response to a request at the last meeting.
This is a quick response. Huh?
Quick response.
The parking spaces?
Yes.
David?
We kind of went circle back after the last meeting to get some more information regarding the request for an additional 51 spaces at George Ranch. And I think part of the discussion was last month was about the available spaces that are sometimes there throughout the course of the school day. And so I circled back and visited with the principals at Holly Ryan and Redding Junior High, who's been an ex-high school principal. My next door neighbors, middle school and junior high principals can be very specific about what they will and will not allow and why. So I sat down with them and said, what would be the pros and cons if we utilize some of those back parking spaces that are behind the schools? And can we flip to the map?
Yeah, go to the next page.
If you'll flip to it, and I'll point to it. This is George Ranch.
Yeah.
And I believe these are there were some available spaces back here. And the discussion was, can we utilize those spaces during these next few years with the growth out of George Ranch for student parking? And some of the things that are listed that the principal shared is that these are very highly utilized spaces during the instructional day because of their enrollment. And I'll use Redding Junior High as an example.
Ms. Hack?
Yes.
Is there a pointer on the... If it is, if you get stand over by the mic, we're having trouble picking you up.
I don't know if I can. I can't see it. Can you point to the back of Redding Junior High?
If you look at that bus event area right there behind Redding Junior High, 7 periods a day, 3 of which are athletic periods. The other 4, because of their enrollment, they're running with 4 PE teachers on those 4 periods. And so because of the enrollment in those 4 periods of the PE, they will have both gyms full, and they also utilize that back parking area, that bus event area. And in fact, Mr. Nava has installed 3 basketball goals back there to increase their play space. They also access that bus event area to get to their football field, which is right behind, which is another area that they use. So there's a lot of student traffic right back there. His preference is that there is no high school student parking allowed in that area. The bus event area right directly behind Polly Ryan, this area between the building and where the red part starts, that is the bus loading and unloading zone. But that also is a high student area that Polly Ryan routinely uses for their exploratory lessons, for a lot of their recess, free activity, things like that. And so, in fact, very few of her staff, she indicated, will park back there because the kids have broken windows in their cars because of balls and things like that. So that is a high traffic area. Mr. Hoyt and the staff went ahead and included the distance between the two campuses to make it over to the high school. There are concerns about having high school students, the foot traffic back and forth if they were to park right there. So there were serious concerns about allowing students back there. I kind of understand their concerns. Anytime you have a large high school students parking in a group, any area, it needs to be monitored. We do have issues that occur in student parking lots with the student parkers, so we would need to make sure that they were monitored. So with that being said, when you come back to this front area, you can kind of see where the high school is currently strategically parking their students. They have 492 spaces available to students in the back. 56 spaces are being allowed for the coaches and the staff that start and end their day. They park back there, but that also helps with managing that student parking lot. We have adults back there. So as a trade-off, 79 spaces are given to students in that front parking lot. Mr. Nava has released 45 additional spaces, and he said that's it, no more. Because if you look, he has 154 spaces available for staff and students, and he has 113 staff that report there during the course of the day. And so with any type of in and out traffic, like substitutes, if they're hosting an event, parking can get very tight. Polly Ryan, they have 64 employees on site. George Ranch has 212 instructional day employees. That is food service, that is custodial, teachers, and all that are involved. So you can see that the parking is getting very, very tight. So the proposal is, and we did check with George Ranch, I believe they have 6 available student parking spaces, Dr. Black confirmed, for the rest of the school year that's available. And those 6 are in that back student parking lot. The 79 and the 45 are full. So with that being said, for the next school year, for 18-19 school year, that we will regain these 48 spaces right here, in addition to the, and add those to the 492 spaces. These are permanently lost. They could be replaced with the 51 spaces that for the dedicated auditorium, or we could go ahead and add the 52 spaces and continue to allow those to be dedicated to the auditorium in the event the school was going to host events that started before the school day dismissed. Any questions on that before I go add any more information? The enrollment this year with that right now is 2635. That's as of today. And that is their parking utilization. If 18-19, we still have the 492 in the back, the front lot, we continue to use 79, Reading continues at 45, we get the 48 back, that'll give us 664 parking spaces before any additions due to the natatorium. The enrollment next year does go up. We have two classes, two grade levels that are over 680 each. So until high school 6 comes down. Any questions?
Okay, I know that's how many spaces we have, and you sell individual spaces.
We do.
On a daily basis, how many of those spaces are empty?
On any given day, they can be empty for a number of reasons, and the reasons that I would like to share would also be the reasons that you that the principals at the middle school and junior high would not want the students parking in the back, because the student parking lot at high school can be very fluid. That's why it requires that type of monitoring. You have kids that are on late arrival. You have kids that are on early off. You have kids that are dual credit.
All right, what time of the day should the parking lots be the most full?
They should be the most full probably between that third period and that fifth period.
Someplace between 10 o'clock and about mm-hmm. 2 o'clock.
Mm-hmm. About 1:45 before they start rolling out.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever had a budding industrial engineer go out there and do a time and motion study on that and tell you how many cars are actually out there?
No, I have not.
Because I'm not a budding industrial engineer, but I've been out there probably 10 times. I go out between 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock. In that backspace there, there are at least 75 spaces every day. In the 45 in front of the junior high, there are at least 12 every day. There's some spots out there that I have been out there a dozen times, and nobody's in those spots. Or at the high school, I see one car parked in the middle of two spaces. I see one car parked across three spaces. In front of the high school itself, I go to the area that's reserved for those kids, and there are at least 20 or 30 spaces there every day. I don't know where they are. Yes, they have been sold. They are committed.
They have been sold.
But they are not used.
They have been sold. Did verify that they were sold to kids that currently have driver's licenses driving cars. Did confirm
yes.
that.
Yes.
You are correct. There was two cars were sold that were given two spaces. The campus principal was not aware of that. That has since been corrected when we looked into that.
But if I were out there
truck.
And I saw that difficulty, I would say no problem. But every day, multiple days, peak times, we simply went to an allocation methodology. You see, first come, first serve, get out here. It may take some of those kids off of Crab River Road 10 minutes before school's supposed to start. They get out there and get their parking spaces. And then you do the first come, first serve, and you fill up that back lot and spill over to the front.
Now, why do we do reserve? I mean, when I was in high school, we had you got a parking pass to park in the just first come, first serve. And what, I mean, if you think about attendance and not seniors, not every senior's there every day. I mean, it's almost like it's an allotment issue. I mean,
Talk about reserved in that who gets to pick their parking space first and they park in the same spot every time.
Why don't we just have, parking lots open and you have a pass to park in the parking lot like college does. And
like it's open parking.
High school, when I was in high school, did, and we never had these problems. I mean,
yeah, you keep the same policy for the rest of the year. Could you do that and then consider?
It's maybe a whole different,
You mean if there's a space.
Sell the same amount of parking.
Passes,
but they just wouldn't have assigned parking spaces.
You never have all the seniors there every. I mean, it's just never.
No, and that's why it doesn't surprise. It really doesn't surprise me, Mr. Steenbergen, when you say that at any given time, not the parking lot is not completely full, even during the peak time. That would not look odd to me at any time, just because that's what I'm used to and walking
every
out.
Day
that
when
the
he's out there 10 days. I mean,
if I see
25 spaces out there, I say, well, it's getting kind of tight. That could. The ebb and flow would take care of that. But when I see consistently 75 spaces, and I can start to consider $212,000 for 50 spaces at $4,000 plus a space. $40 a year takes 100 a year to pay for a space.
And it's 3 years, whatever, years when we're in the beginning in high school.
Getting relief.
You've provided the data, and I've said my asking the questions about if you've ever looked to see who's really parking out there. So,
how much do they charge the students to buy a parking
$40.
$25 and $40. I believe those are the two fees. That could be, yes.
Two fees?
Well, they try to be reasonable, yeah. And they, I will tell you that they did a comparison with neighboring districts and what they were charging, and we're a really good deal.
Another quick question, though. Are all the ones that have the painted spots in there, are those student parking?
No. Well, in the past, it was not. It was staff or students, because the staff that have a parking tag and it has an assigned number to where they staff.
No, I mean the painted, where they paint their,
they decorate.
Their logo, their something, their symbol.
It could be either, but I'm not 100% sure. But
okay,
I,
because I noticed areas you have are designated for staff parking. When I'm out there, I see empty spaces that have those painted. It looks like students.
I think that's certainly. I appreciate the observations and that type of thing, but I also know from experience that when kids do not have parking spaces, you will also get some feedback from those as well. And so I just want to make sure, because there are times at this building, for example, you can come out here and there are tons of parking spaces available, but then when we have meetings, we got people parking out in the grass. So, but I totally respect the comments, but I also want to just validate the fact that the people that are out there every day managing those folks in and out are the ones that also deal with some of those phone calls when that impact really exists. And I certainly am not inclined to be promoting additional monies being spent for spaces. But I'm also inclined to make sure that we are reminded that there will be a point when there will be vehicles not being able to park on those campuses.
It's interesting because we included some Foster High School. They have a waiting list, Foster High School does. They've had a waiting list for a couple years, and even though their enrollments come down with Fulshear High School, you want to pull that slide, they're at 2,100, and they'll drop below that 2,100 next year because their classes get a little bit smaller. But confirmed today that Briscoe is allowing, giving them 29 spots on the side of Briscoe and Foster. Foster High School has a phone call into Mr. Pineda requesting additional spaces, and he's considering an additional 25, but on the Briscoe-Wertheimer side. So, yeah.
The natatorium itself, did it take up
some spaces? Yeah.
How many spaces?
40.
Okay, so those spaces were there before the natatorium, so we actually are decreasing the original amount of parking spaces.
But they're adding, they are adding some.
You lost 40, we lost 41.
Part of the project, 51 will be constructed.
You'd be adding an additional 10.
One of the other nuances here, we've got 48 spaces currently being occupied by construction equipment, and we still have 75 spaces back there not being used. So, that's... Okay. We beat that horse. Let's move
yes,
on.
Ma'am. Just one other. When you do assign parking spaces, that's also a security reason, too, because then you know if something happens in a specific area, y'all can track back.
Yes. When they have assigned parking spaces, you know it's very easy for the parking lot monitor to monitor the kids and the teachers that are on duty. You know where they should be parking and who is out there.
So that's I think that's probably why it was put into place, I know, a while back, was for security, too.
My experience is it's easier managing parking lots when they have an assigned spot versus open.
Next item on the agenda was consider approval of site utility easements for Culver Elementary School. Help me with a page.
I know, so many pages.
Next item on the agenda is consider approval of award for district-wide access controls. Next item, we ask the board to approve Terracon for materials testing for water and plant upgrade at Foster High School in the amount of $15,620. The next item is consider approval of new appraisers for teachers, teaching staff for 2017-2018 school year. And the next item is consider approval of backup infrastructure upgrades. Those are all the action items, Mr. President.
Thank you. Information items, of course, we've got the board policies first reading. You can work through those at your leisure. Any comments or questions on those tonight? We did have a couple strays in the back of that. We can have Exhibit A, page 207 and 208, 209. We're not on that list. You might just want to add those to that list. Parent involvement update. Any comments, questions? Commission on. Standard tax collection report, payment for projects. Fund. As I mentioned on the, we will have an update on Thursday night on the Holdsworth Center. And yes, then we will have on the operational audit, we'll have a presentation to give a preview of what's about to come out on that. Do we have any audience to patrons on any of the action items?
There it is.
Thank you. Any other comments, questions from the board? If not, we'll call the meeting adjourned at 7:39. Thank you for participation tonight.